When pediatricians examine babies in the hospital, what are you looking for?
So after babies are born, there's a lot of changes that go on in their bodies. All of a sudden, their lungs are opening and filled with air, which is how they get oxygen, rather than through the umbilical cord. The heart undergoes some changes to adapt to being outside of mom and into the oxygen-filled world. And so there's things that we want to observe to make sure that they're going correctly. So we listen to the heart, we listen to the lungs to make sure that they sound and are working properly. Most of the time that happens smoothly, and it's one of the miracles of nature that we get to watch all those changes that have to happen, that happen without any input from parents or pediatricians or nurses. But we want to be there and aware if something doesn't go according to plan. Ultrasounds are great and give us a good idea if there's going to be issues for babies to be aware of when they're
born. Like ultrasounds during the pregnancy.
Mm-hmm. But not always, they don't always catch certain things. And so we are looking to make sure that there's no other surprises on baby's exam. And we do a head-to-toe exam. We're looking at the soft spot and down to the toes, counting, make sure there's all 10. And specific things that we're looking for are to examine closely the heart and the lungs, but everywhere. We look at the eyes, ears, and make sure that everything's working like it should.
What are some common concerns or issues that you see in the hospital when you examine a baby?
So a very common concern that parents have is that baby is not getting enough to eat. We know that for moms that choose to breastfeed, which we encourage, that it takes a few days for mom's breast milk to arrive, to come in, as we sometimes say. And babies are designed for that. They are designed to be born with extra water weight that they pee off, and they lose some weight as they're waiting for milk to come in. But that's normal. We say physiologic. That's the way that babies' bodies are supposed to work. And so that weight loss that some parents can get concerned about in the first few days is actually normal. We do watch it closely because we don't want babies to lose too much weight. We want to make sure that they're not getting dehydrated because feeding's not going as well as it should, although we know that there is some wiggle room for that because it takes time for mom's milk to come in. So we watch what babies' weights closely and make sure that we can help with feeding while you're there in the hospital, and we have nurses and lactation specialists that can help rather than having you have to go to an appointment later after you've been discharged because things aren't going as well.
And moms need lots of confidence before they go home. There's
yes.
nothing that can cause more anxiety than going home feeling like you're not mm-hmm. capable of feeding your baby.
Mm-hmm. And we know there's still going to be some learning that mm-hmm. goes on when you mm-hmm. go home, and things change as baby gets older and as you just have to adjust from being in the nursery to being home. A lot of questions mm-hmm. are going to come up, but we want moms to feel confident and supported and know what resources are out there if questions do come up. Another concern that comes up is jaundice. So that's another physiologic thing that babies normally do. Most babies have some jaundice. They're born with extra red blood cells, and those red blood cells are a younger type designed for fetuses, so unborn babies, that are a little more fragile and get broken down as babies are born into an oxygen-rich environment. And one of the byproducts or waste products of those red blood cells is bilirubin, which makes babies look a little yellow or jaundiced. And that's a normal process that we expect to happen. The problem is that bilirubin can be dangerous for the babies if it gets too high too fast. And so that's why we keep a close eye on that as well. And every baby should have a bilirubin checked before they leave the hospital. And then they might need to be checked closer after they've left the hospital, depending on where it is.
Are there risk factors for having jaundice?
So family history is a good predictor. So if parents were babies that needed therapy for jaundice as babies themselves, that can be a predictor. Girls tend to do better than boys. So boys are a little higher risk for jaundice than the girls. And then babies that have blood type incompatibilities between mom and baby, there can be some attacking of mom's antibodies against baby's blood cells. And so if those blood cells are being broken down faster than normal, they can have bilirubin increases faster than normal.
If a baby is born premature, does mm-hmm. that also increase yep. their chance?
One of the things, so we know that the bilirubin is going to be released by that process I discussed, but it's also going to be eliminated by the liver. And if the liver is immature, which it usually is for babies, it's not going to process that as well. So that's one of the contributing factors. The more premature the baby is, the more immature that liver is going to process the bilirubin as well. And so that can be another risk factor.
And you mentioned one of the first concerns is feeding, but that goes along with jaundice. Mm-hmm. How do the two affect each other?
So I like to think of bilirubin being excreted through the urine and through poop. And the more the baby is peeing and pooping, the more that they're going to get rid of that bilirubin. And the thing that produces the most urine and the most poop is good feeding. So we know that babies are waiting for mom's milk to come in at the beginning, and that as long as jaundice isn't an issue, we're happy to let that take its course and wait for mom's milk to come in. If jaundice becomes an issue or if weight loss becomes too extreme, then we sometimes will recommend supplementation. So continuing to breastfeed, but adding in some formula feeds as well.
It doesn't mean that you absolutely have to formula feed forever going forward. It's just for that short amount of time.
Yes, usually while we're dealing with the jaundice or waiting for mom's milk to come in. But we want to encourage feeding for babies that are jaundiced to the point that we're either concerned that they might need therapy or that they might need therapy. We want to encourage as much pee and poop as we can to help lower that bilirubin level.